Good afternoon, everyone. This is a joint work with Jiasen Yang and Professor Petros Drinias. Both are from Purdue. Here, we propose an iterative algorithm based on randomized metric sketching, which very closely approximates any projected data point under the Fisher discriminant analysis setup. Now, in machine learning and multivariate statistics, Fisher discriminant analysis, or FDA, is a widely used method for both classification and dimension reduction simultaneously. So far, it has been successfully applied to many such problems, including text classification, face recognition, image classification, and so on. First, I will start with giving a brief introduction for those of you who are not so familiar with the idea of FDA. We are given n data points in 2D, and there are two distinct classes or levels attached with these points, let's say red and blue. Now, our objective is to project these points onto a lower dimensional space in a way so as to keep these two classes of points maximally separated from each other. In other words, we want to find a line x such that if we project these data points onto x, then the variability of these projected points between the classes is maximum and the variability within each class is minimum. Therefore, x is basically the maximizer of the ratio of between class variance and within class variance of these projected data points. And it is also called the discriminant vector. Next, we generalize this from two dimension to d dimension, and it turns out that this particular optimization problem boils down to a generalized eigen problem of equation one, where x is the discriminant vector we are interested in, but now in d dimension. Lambda is a non-negative scalar. Sigma B and sigma T are respectively the between class scatter matrix and the total scatter matrix of order D by D, which are defined on the slide, where M is the row-wise grand mean of the data, Nj is the size of the jth class, and Mj is the row-wise mean of the jth class. Next, we further extend this from a two-class problem to a multi-class problem with C distinct classes. In that case, this particular formulation in equation 1 can be expressed in a matrix form as in equation 2, where x is now a matrix of all the discriminant vectors we are interested in, and lambda is a diagonal matrix with the corresponding non-negative lambda i's arranged in a non-increasing order. Next, let A be the mean center data matrix of order n by d, and there is a very elegant linear algebraic formulation of multi-class FDA. From this 2010 JMLR paper, which actually expressed the between class scatter matrix sigma B as A transpose omega, omega transpose A, and the total scatter matrix was expressed as A transpose A. Here, omega is an n by c matrix called the rescaled class membership matrix, which is defined on the slide. Now, look at the right-hand side of equation 3. If this matrix A transpose A is invertible, then we can rewrite this as in equation 4, and the pairs lambda I, xi are the corresponding eigenpairs of the problem. However, in this work, we typically consider the setting where D is much larger than N, in which case the computation of the left-hand side of equation 4 becomes numerically unstable. A standard way to get around this is to solve the regularized version of this problem, which is given in equation 5, and nu is called the regularization parameter. Next, we can further rewrite this in terms of a matrix G in equation 6, and the matrix G is defined on the next line, and both these expressions of G are equal. Now, note that equation 6 doesn't have a unique solution. And in particular, if the matrix X is a solution, then for any non-singular diagonal matrix D, XD is also a solution. Exploiting this nice property, the same 2010 JMLR paper presented an eigenvalue decomposition-based algorithm which showed that instead of projecting the data points onto the actual solution matrix X, if we project them onto this new matrix G, then also the distance between any two projected data points are preserved. This implies for any distance-based classification methods, such as k-nearest neighbors, both these matrices X and G would result in same predictions. Therefore, it is reasonable to shift our interest from this actual solution matrix X to this new matrix G. And basically, both these equations 6 and 7 are the building blocks of our iterative algorithm and the following analysis. Next, the exact computation of G takes time, which is of order n squared d. And this is very, very expensive because d is very large in our setting. Whereas in a much faster way, our iterative framework computes a new matrix G hat, which is a very close approximation to G. I'll get into this in a while, but before that, let's discuss some of the important notions which will be required in the analysis part of our work. Next, let rho be the rank of the matrix A, and note that this rho is strictly less than n because the matrix A itself is already mean-centered. Now, in context of regularized Fisher discriminant analysis, or RFDA, equation 8 defines the effective degrees of freedom of the problem, and which is denoted by d nu, where sigma i's are the non-zero singular values of A, and nu is the regularization parameter as defined. Now note that this d nu is always upper bounded by rho. However, it can be much smaller than that depending on the distributions of sigma i's as well as the specific choice of lambda. Next, we define the ith column leverage score of A, which is the squared L2 norm of the ith row of the matrix V. And similarly, we define ith column ridge leverage score of A, which is again the squared L2 norm of the ith row of the matrix V times sigma nu. Here, V is the matrix of top row right singular vectors of A, and sigma nu is a row by row diagonal matrix as defined on the slide. Next, here is our iterative algorithm, which takes the following inputs: the data matrix A, the class membership matrix omega, regularization parameter nu, number of iterations t, and a suitably constructed sketching matrix S. Later on, I'll briefly talk about how to construct S. Now, coming back to our algorithm, what it precisely does is it roughly solves the RFDA problem at each iteration with respect to a new matrix Lj and returns an intermediate solution vector G tilde j. Now, what is this matrix Lj? It basically contains the information about omega, which were not captured in the previous iterations. Finally, we sum up all these intermediate solution matrices, G tilde j's, to get G hat, which is a very close approximation to G. It is to be noted that our algorithm can also be viewed as a preconditioned Richardson iteration with step size equals to 1. However, the analysis of our algorithm is novel and offers several advantages over the conventional Richardson method. Next, here is our main structural result, which presents the accuracy guarantees of our algorithm under certain conditions. Precisely, for any given epsilon lies between 0 and 1, part A of our result shows that as long as this sketching matrix S satisfies this particular structural condition given on the slide, then the output of our algorithm G hat indeed results in a additive error guarantee and closely approximates any projected data point. And the bound is given in equation 9. Similarly, part B shows that if the sketching matrix S satisfies another structural constraint, which is different from the one in part A, then also the distance between the approximate projection and the optimal projection is bounded by a quantity which is very similar to that of part A. In fact, right-hand side of both of these bounds in equation 9 and 10 actually depends on the part of the data point W that lies on the row space of A. Now, there is a common aspect between both part A and part B of our result, which is under both these structural conditions, our algorithm actually converges exponentially fast as the number of iterations T increases. This is indeed a very, very important aspect of our result. Now, the question is how to construct the sketching matrix S such that these two structural conditions get satisfied with high probability. Here, we use a standard construction algorithm from randomized linear algebra literature, which returns the sketching matrix S in the form of the so-called sampling and rescaling matrix. This is how this algorithm works. Suppose we are given D numbers, 1 to D, from which we want to sample with replacement, and the probability of ith number to be drawn at any given trial is denoted by Pi. Let smallest denotes the desired sample size, which is also given. And finally, we initialize the sketching matrix S to be a null matrix of order D by smallest. Now, if the jth trial results in ith number, then we replace the ijth element of the sketching matrix S with a new quantity, which is 1 divided by square root of smallest times pi. And this process continues until we reach the desired sample size, which is smallest. Output of this algorithm indeed results in a very, very sparse matrix, and the sparsity is given by small s. And you can also see from this example that the output matrix S has one and only one non-zero entry per column. Next, this result ensures that such constructions of the sketching matrix S indeed satisfy the structural conditions of our main result. With high probability under both leverage and ridge leverage score sampling. In particular, if the sampling probabilities are proportional to the column leverage scores of A, then it satisfies the first structural condition, and the number of samples it requires is of order rho log rho. And similarly, if the sampling probabilities are proportional to the ridge leverage scores of A, then it satisfies the second structural condition, and the sample size requirements is of order d nu log d nu. Here, d nu is the effective degrees of freedom of the problem, which we already discussed can be much smaller than rho. Therefore, ridge leverage score sampling indeed results in a very similar guarantee as compared to the leverage score sampling, but with a much smaller sample size requirement. Next, here is the running time of our algorithm, which you can see is much faster than the exact computation time under both leverage and ridge leverage score sampling. And moreover, the running time of our algorithm depends on the sparsity of the input matrix A, which implies as the matrix A gets sparser, our algorithm becomes even faster. Next, our structural conditions can also be satisfied using other random projection-based constructions of the sketching matrix S, such as count sketch or subsampled randomized Hadamard transforms. These are often more accurate and more sample efficient as compared to the sampling-based constructions. However, these projection-based sketches linearly combine all the original columns of the data matrix, which results in a loss in terms of interpretability of the data. Next, to summarize our finding, we basically presented a simple iterative sketching-based framework for regularized Fisher discriminant analysis, which guarantees high quality approximation with respect to the optimal projection. And ours is the first analysis where ridge leverage scores were used to sample the columns of the data matrix. And we showed that the sample size depends on the effective degrees of freedom of the problem and not on the rank of the matrix. Now, in this context, An interesting open problem might be, what if we use different sketching matrices? In other words, if we use different sketching matrices in each iteration of our algorithm, how will it influence the convergence? Will it make our algorithm even faster? For the interest of time, let me just stop here. For other theoretical aspects of our work and the experiments conducted, you are most welcome to talk to me offline. Thank you so much for your kind attention.